Welcome to the session that answers one of the most recurring questions of people learning to image or visualize for the first time. What can I do to become a better visualizer? How can I create more vivid images? Are there exercises that will help me create clear mental pictures? It is so frustrating to close my eyes and not be able to see anything. The answer, of course, is that with relatively little training, most people can become excellent visualizers. The ability to visualize, like any other talent, is distributed in the population within the range of the now familiar bell-shaped curve. Approximately 6 to 10% of the population are visualizing virtuosos. They have more recently been identified as fantasy-prone individuals. Some of their characteristics are a very active and imaginative fantasy life, a great capacity for self-absorption and losing themselves in their activities. Creative activities come easily for them, they are usually quite suggestible, and they make excellent hypnotic subjects. The rest of us have varying degrees of proficiency in creating mental movies, but with practice, we can very quickly move ourselves up to within the virtuoso range. Of course, no one needs to be reminded that everyone in the world visualizes vividly, in color, every night, during our 2 hours or so of dream time. In an earlier session, I indicated that the details of mental imagery are just as important, or even more so in some instances, than the vividness of an image. True. However, as you focus on the details of a specific outcome that you are programming for your life, you'll find that the image will become increasingly more lucid, thereby making it more real for the subconscious. It would be analogous to listening to music through quadraphonic speakers, adding new dimensions to your experiencing rather than through the single channel limitations of one speaker. By increasing the realness of an image, it becomes more likely that the mental picture will take with your deeper mind and increase the likelihood of that reality manifesting in your life. As I reviewed the history of creative imagination and visualization, I was struck by the number of disciplines over the ages that emphasize the importance of regular practice to enhance the vividness of closed-eye visualization. For example, during the Middle Ages, witches allowed themselves to be placed inside a large, black, light-proof cloth sack, which was sealed and attached by a rope to a branch of a tree. This was known as a witch's cradle, and the gentle breezing of the wind would cause the cradle to sway in different directions, disorienting the witch inside. Following 10 minutes or so of these disorienting movements, the witch would begin to experience vivid images, almost like a waking dream, which became the basis for their prophecies and in many cases resulted in being burned at the stake for their efforts. In the late 1800s, geneticist and statistician Sir Francis Galton attended several sessions by a French educator who trained his students to visualize clearly in 3 dimensions. The students were urged to examine an object carefully so they could form a clear mental image. Next, they were directed to draw it in midair so they could develop muscular memories of the object. After practicing for several weeks, the students could summon images with ease, and they developed the capacity for clear visual images. Conversely, some of the students neglected to continue their practice, and their ability for visualizing atrophied. This is true of any system in the body that's not nurtured. In other words, use it or lose it. The use of imagery in personal growth and psychotherapy was pioneered by Sigmund Freud. He would evoke images by pressing on his patients' foreheads. Later, by having his patients recline on a couch with eyes closed, they would free associate to whatever thoughts would enter their minds. With very little practice, his patients began to report a flooding of images, which in time became a waking dream. Early in my career, I trained in psychoanalytic therapy and was astonished at how easily I could evoke images by simply free associating to my thoughts and then actively describing what appeared on my mind's eye screen. The more I described the detail of my images, the clearer they became. Freud's colleague, Carl Jung, regarded mental imagery to be a fundamental creative aspect of the psyche for personal growth. He developed the technique of active imagination, that he considered superior to dreams in quickening psychological development. After World War II, psychiatrists Hans Carl Leuner and Robert de Sual developed a technique called guided affective imagery, which evoked rich waking dreams and improved a person's capacity for developing clear mental images. Again, I took special training in these traditions as I realized how simple and how powerful these techniques were for developing insights and accelerating personal growth. The various imagery techniques have similar commonalities, and they have all been brought together in a book entitled Psychosynthesis by psychiatrist Roberto Assagioli. In my personal experiences, I was directed to lie down, progressively relax each of my muscle groupings, and then was asked to begin describing every detail of what was on my mind's eye screen. Initially, there was just the darkness of my closed eyelids, but as I began to actively describe out loud each small shadow, blob, germinal image, or phosphene, within minutes, the imagery became clearer, richer, and more vivid. I was elated, as I always thought of myself as a non-visualizer in those days. My patients began to report similar experiences improving their visualizations, and I became convinced that everyone has the potential and the innate capacity for creating clear mental movies. The reason for providing you with this brief historical background on enhancing imagery is to introduce you to the process we will be using to help you learn how to develop clear, easy-to-sense visual images. The technique has been labeled image streaming and was developed by Dr. Win Wenger of the Institute of Visual Thinking in Maryland. Dr. Wenger's methods are very similar to the older traditions. Even though image streaming has much in common to guided affective imagery and the techniques I just sketched out for you, Dr. Wenger should be given credit for the term image streaming and his use of the procedure in education and creative problem solving. Image streaming has been widely used for personal growth, corporate problem solving, and think tanking. An additional and unexpected benefit is that in at least one study with physics students at Southwest State University in Minnesota, the students experienced an average 20-point increase in their IQs after only 25 hours of practicing image streaming. Your left brains are probably wondering, hey, how can that be? How can a person increase their IQs when intelligence is considered, in most professional circles, to be inborn and determined by the laws of heredity? I initially subscribed to that notion, even though many psychologists could not come up with an agreed-upon definition of intelligence other than what IQ tests measured. Today, one of the most recurring themes in defining intelligence is that it is the art of paying attention. Thus, image streaming relies on visualizing, paying attention to the minutest of details, free association, some intellectual analysis, and speaking out loud. By doing all these functions simultaneously, one ends up stimulating different brain regions. This is referred to by Dr. Wenger as pole bridging, which links subcortical or subconscious functions to the visual cortex, the speech area, sensory motor areas of the brain, and the frontal lobes into single combined activities. Thus, intelligence could be increased by building up communication channels from disparate parts of the brain. In PET scans and other imaging studies of more intelligent persons' brains, the wiring is indeed more complex, but it takes less energy or work to solve problems. Thus, image streaming could conceivably increase overall intelligence and problem solving. Long-term image streamers have reported an increase in their ability to sustain focus and concentrate, a much better attention span, an improvement in their powers of observation, a sharpening of one's awareness of the world in general, and an increase in the vividness, frequency, and recall of their dreams, regaining the lucid visualizing abilities they once had as children. For the remainder of this session, I'd like you to treat it as a workshop, where an exercise or process is first described and followed by either working alone or with a partner to practice and imprint the skill you wish to acquire. All imagery work should be done in a mental, safe place, preferably the same place each time. In the guided visualization cassette that comes with this program, you'll be asked to imagine a magical garden as your safe place. As a matter of fact, so many people have responded so favorably to this image that I'm now using this very special setting as a starting point for all my guided imagery programs. So, now, with open eyes, as you're listening to this cassette, I'd like you to see, sense, picture, or imagine the following aspects to your magical garden. Picture it full of medicinal plants, healing herbs, and various kinds of shrubs and rich, lush, green vegetation and flowers. Off to one side, imagine an extra-thick patch of soft, silky grass, a power spot, where the force field or gravitational pull of the Earth is extra strong. Nearby, sense a slow-moving, shallow stream. And as you look upstream, in the near distance, you can see an average-sized waterfall with a ledge protruding halfway up and a gentle rainbow mist of colors spraying in a soft breeze. Also nearby, picture a large door frame-like structure approximately 7 feet in height and 5 feet across with a very fine gold mesh screen stretched between the two side frames and from the ground to the top of the framework. Across the top of the frame, imagine an arch sign that reads in bold print, Magnetic Belief Screen. Finally, in a nearby secluded area of your garden, mentalize or imagine a sanctuary, a place of calm and safety, with some type of structure such as a gazebo, or even a healing temple or chapel, depending on your preference. As you can see, I use different words to stimulate your visual imagination. Sense, see, picture, visualize, mentalize, imagine, and so on. Most people can sense, but try each of these words and use the metaphor that works best for you. If all else fails, pretend you can visualize. The warm-up exercise for image streaming can be done in one of two ways. One, alone, but recording all your responses onto a tape recorder, or two, with a partner who records your responses. It should be noted that many couples choose to work and practice with each other. This has led to stimulating each other's enthusiasm as they become better visualizers to program certain goals together, such as the purchase of a new house. Are you ready to start image streaming? Great! Before beginning the exercise, select the scene, either your magical garden or a memorable scene from your past, such as a breathtaking sunset, a walk through a forest with shafts of light streaming through, or a meadow with a sea of grass and wildflowers scattered all over. The steps of this exercise are as follows. 1. Make yourself comfortable. Preferably lying down, loose clothing. Possible distractions such as telephones should be muted or disconnected. 2. Progressively relax yourself, starting with all the muscles in your scalp and face. Then move down through each muscle grouping through your neck, chest, upper back, middle and lower back muscles, continuing down through the lower body, buttocks, thighs, and lower legs. With very little practice, most people can achieve a comfortable degree of relaxation in about 2 or 3 minutes. 3. Out loud, begin describing a scene from memory or your magical garden as you are looking at it with your mental eyes. The important thing is to keep describing, keep talking out loud, with as few pauses or downtime as possible. 4. For the initial warm-up session, continue image streaming for 4 to 5 minutes. 5. At this point, you will find yourself becoming more absorbed with the images and you will start shifting deeper into your experience. as best you can, embellish your descriptions, describing some of the special qualities that make your scene so special and distinctive for an additional 2 to 3 minutes. 6. Bring into your garden or scene a person that you know or know of who has extraordinarily sensitive powers of perception and imaging. If you don't know of anyone personally, think of an artist or cinematographer whose work you admire, since most artists are gifted visualizers. Another choice might be of a child that is familiar to you, since most children up to ages of 6 or 7 are visualizing virtuosos until they start school and stop using their imaging right brain. 7. Begin describing this person, friend, child, artist, to your partner. In other words, image stream your world-class visualizer, describing in the greatest detail what he or she looks like. Image stream for 1 or 2 minutes. Details, details. No downtime. 8. Then, to get inside the experience of being more perceptive, put your expert visualizer's head on your head, like you would put on a football helmet. 9. For the next 2 or 3 minutes, describe your beautiful scene or garden through their eyes, allowing yourself to embellish the sensory richness of your descriptions through the perceptions of your invited observer. 10. Return your observer's head to their body and mentally thank them if you wish. 11. Orient yourself back to an alert state without rushing the process. And finally, 12. Take the next several minutes and debrief, either into the recorder or with your partner. Be sure to share what worked best for you, which images, senses, colors, textures were easiest to picture or feel, and which provided you with some difficulty. Also, compare your imaging abilities through your own mental eyes and those of your expert observer. This rather imaginative technique of perceiving through someone else's eyes has been used in a number of studies on creativity and problem solving. However, one of the most innovative applications of borrowing someone else's imagination was developed by Dr. Robert Hartley of the University of London. He had been trying different approaches in his work with disadvantaged children in an attempt to improve their dismal academic performance. Dr. Hartley recalled an instance where he experienced a massive mental block in his own efforts to write an essay. He wondered how a well-known, articulate TV newscaster would handle it. At this desperate point, Dr. Hartley fused with and became the TV anchorman. Almost miraculously, the sentences flowed effortlessly until he completed the assignment. He wondered, would this technique help culturally disadvantaged, low self-esteem kids who always did poorly on tests? He tested a group of children on a common picture-matching test. The children were then instructed, "Think of someone you know who is very clever. Now, be an actor. Close your eyes, put that person's head on, imagine that you are that clever person, and do the test the way he or she would." The results were astonishing. Scores rose significantly, and the low achievers' test behavior was almost identical to the grades of high achievers. Somewhat revealingly, several of the children protested, saying, "Ah, it wasn't me that scored so well. It was the clever one that did it." It's not surprising that someone with a negative self-image would negate or disavow such remarkable positive results. Incidentally, if you have a child that's afraid of taking risks or making mistakes, the bored expert's head is an excellent technique, since if a mistake is made, the child can always say, "I didn't goof up, the other guy did." Several self-esteem studies have used variations of that theme with very encouraging results. We'll be using the bored expert's head technique from time to time as a means of empowering your imagination and creativity. Before proceeding with the basic image streaming technique, be certain that you have practiced the warm-up exercise of the magical garden at least once, preferably twice. The steps for learning to image stream are very similar to describing your magical garden out loud. Again, you can do this exercise alone, but make certain you have a tape recorder nearby that will pick up your voice as you describe what you are sensing out loud, or preferably, with a partner who will tape record the session and encourage you to keep talking. It's best to do the exercise lying down, but the choice is optional. Close your eyes, and to provide you with an alternative calming technique to progressive relaxation, focus on your breathing. Begin by inhaling deeply, hold your breath, and simultaneously tense all the muscles in your upper body only. Hold it for 10 seconds or so, and as you exhale slowly, gently release all the tension in your muscles. Do this 4 or 5 times, and then allow your breathing to flow more naturally, slowly, and smoothly, the way you might stroke a soft piece of velvet. While you are breathing in, holding, and releasing, a part of you may imagine that you're inhaling relaxation, exhaling tension. Inhaling relaxation, exhaling tension. Once relaxed to your satisfaction, begin an out loud, rapid flow description of your stream of perceptions, remembering eyes are closed throughout. As with a Magic Garden warm-up, the richer and more detailed the description of your image streaming, the greater the benefits. This is a very important point. In contrast to describing your magic garden, begin describing whatever appears on your blank perceptual field, that is, the backs of your eyelids. For most people, it initially appears blank or dark. Regardless, begin describing out loud any blob, splotch of color, rudimentary image, phosphine, or fleeting abstract lines in an exaggerated, detailed fashion. As the blobs begin changing into other images, they may turn into a long-forgotten scene, a face, or a memory that will take on visual features. Then, out loud, describe, 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 with vivid details, 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 in the present tense, as if it's happening now, which of course it is. You may feel like you're making some of it up, but keep describing. After a few moments, the images will flow much easier, and they'll become richer and more vivid. At this point, some people have said, the images seem to have taken on a life of their own. I had to talk fast to keep up. In the first 2 or 3 image streaming sessions, some people feel as if they're making it up. It doesn't matter. Even if you pretend from time to time, the important thing is to keep describing your stream of consciousness. Each image streaming session should last for no longer than 8 to 10 minutes. If you're with a partner, take a few moments to debrief and share your perception and feelings of the experience. Occasionally, for some people, it may be very difficult to sense anything, let alone images or even blobs of color. What can one do if pictures don't come? Here are 5 techniques that I would like to share with you that I have found very helpful. The after-image technique is perhaps the best way of kick-starting reluctant images. Stare at a fairly strong light source for approximately 1 minute. Never use the sun or a light source brighter than 100 watts. Then, close your eyes and begin describing this after-image of the light source. You will be pleased to discover the after-image will be in several colors, which, with ongoing descriptions, will be followed by a kaleidoscope of images. As you keep describing, this will lead into spontaneous image streaming. A second technique for creating a bridge into image streaming is the old dream recall method. Recall a recent dream, or even a fragment of a dream, and begin describing it in the present tense, that is, looking at it now rather than as a memory. You may feel like you're making parts of it up, and you may go back and forth briefly from memories to the more spontaneous flow of image streaming. The third technique you may have already practiced. Think of a person who is a good visualizer, and place your invited observer's head on your own, like putting on a football helmet, and begin image streaming through the expert's perceptions and senses. This method works for almost everyone I have tried it with. Next, you may wish to go back to your magical garden describe aloud technique, which you have already practiced. Again, some of the images will start breaking through, and the garden images will blend and fuse into image streaming. The final alternative, or, if all else fails technique, pretend. You may start with an image or images from memory, or with pretend images. With ongoing, detailed descriptions, the pretend images will blend into image streaming. In other words, fake it until you make it. One other suggestion. The harder one works on creating or sensing images, the less effective the outcome. All the exercises in this program should be done with a sense of lightheartedness and fun. In other words, combine the focus of your left brain with the playfulness of the right brain. With a little practice, you'll find your own groove that is compatible with your psychology and mind style. I cannot encourage you enough to make the initial investment of practicing image streaming, 10 minutes a day for 10 days. 10 minutes a day for 10 days, and you will be able to instantly access vivid imagery in the same fashion that some of the most intellectually productive and creative minds have been doing for centuries. A couple in a recent visualization workshop I conducted followed the procedures I have shared with you, and within 2 weeks, they were discovering insights about themselves that added a new dimension to the relationship, a byproduct of image streaming that they had not counted on. As you become more adept at image streaming, you will discover recurring themes and symbolic messages embedded in your flow of consciousness. Since some of the most ordinary appearing messages might hold deeper symbolic meanings, the challenge, and fun, is to identify and play with the significance of these messages. Over time, these spontaneous images will begin revealing powerful insights, leading to greater self-understanding and creativity, not to mention your increasing abilities for vivid visualizations. In our next session, we will learn to use image streaming as a tool for identifying and overcoming the roadblocks or obstacles to our success.